Check one, two, perfect. Oh my gosh, thank you for that lengthy introduction. That was fantastic. Gosh, I don't know, following up Greg Sears, canola producers. I don't want to say that Greg's boring, I don't want to say that. But last night when we got in and we went for drinks, the bar manager came and asked Greg if he could step outside so they could start happy hour. I'm a little disappointed in the schedule today, I'm not going to lie. I was very specific with Ken that I'd be on when there was drinks being served. I'm a lot funnier when there's drinks being served, and here I am right after breakfast, and everyone's got full bellies, so we're gonna have a little bit of fun today. My goal, I got three goals. First one is, hope to entertain you a little bit. We're gonna have a little bit of fun. Number two, we wanna talk about weather, severe weather. We wanna hopefully have some learning going on today. And then number three, hope to inspire you a little bit and kick things off and have a great conference. So. Here's where I'm going to start. Just going to mention that I am not a meteorologist. I'm not a classically trained scientist by any stretch of the imagination. I'm a photographer. And I got into severe weather, and I learned everything I know about severe weather because of photography. My goal is always to tell amazing stories with photographs. My goal is to share as much information as I can through my photographs. Problem is that as a weather photographer, if you can't get close to the weather, there's a problem because then I can't get the photographs. And so I've had to learn the meteorology side of it kind of on the job. So let me be clear though that as a photographer, I used to photograph a lot of things, like including weddings. And whether I was photographing a wedding or whether I was photographing a thunderstorm or my kids at their hockey game, the goal is always the same for a photographer. The goal is always the same, and that is to tell an interesting story. And I know I've told an interesting story when you look at a photograph that I've taken and you have an emotional connection to it. That's always my goal. If it's on the front cover of the newspaper put it there because they want you to buy that newspaper, okay? For those of you who aren't familiar, a newspaper is this thing that we used to get in the mailbox every morning. You'd open it up, it was made of paper and had writing on it. So let's look at this photo, for example. This is a picture of a wedding. And on the bride and groom's wedding day, we got back from doing the wedding photos, and oh my gosh, we got a flat tire in the car. This is a true story. This actually happened. But of course, on his wedding day, I'm not going to make the groom change the tire. Now, whether you love the photo or hate it, the point is that we all had a little chuckle when we saw it on the screen. And that's because it's an interesting story, and that's why we care about it. That's always my goal with a photograph. How about this one? Favorite shot of my youngest daughter. Let's be clear here, guys. If you're not laughing, you're wrong, okay? This is a one-minute-old baby giving me the finger. I've been planning this kid's wedding now for 10 years. How much fun are we going to have at her wedding? How about this shot, though? Different emotional connection, right? We heard it in the room. We heard the mood in the room literally flip 180 the moment that picture came up on screen. This is a small town in Nebraska. It's getting hit with an EF4 tornado. From the time it entered town to the time it left town was 22 seconds. 150 homes, 15 businesses flying up in the air. Now we think about that small town that you're in, that community that's close by. And we can imagine, we can put ourselves in that position. We have the images still locked in our head from Black Friday in Edmonton back in 87, right? Edmonton Tornado and Pine Lake, and the list goes on and on. When we see a picture like this, a lot of times people say, like, Greg, what about the creep factor? Like, you got your camera out and, like, people's lives are being destroyed. Isn't there a creep factor of having your camera out? But here's the thing about that photo. I want you to imagine any small town you've ever been in, your small town. I want you to imagine that hall. And every town in North America has that hall. And it's like a Legion hall or an Elks hall or some church basement. But everyone's got that hall. And somewhere on the wall, there's a picture. And that picture commemorates or memorializes something that happened in that community. The elevator burned down in 82, or that time the men all got onto the train and took off for the Second World War. And we have those pictures, and they're burned into our psyche. For this community, I want you to imagine 50 years from now, they have a memorial dinner. They gather everybody together, and people get up, and they make some speeches and stuff. Think about how important an image like that is for Pilger, Nebraska. And that's Pilger, Nebraska. It's not just some small town. I know because it says on the water tower, Pilger, Nebraska. And I also know because we were about 250 yards away when this was happening. And as tragic as it is, and believe me, there's a lot of tragedy happened that day. A lot of people's lives were changed. But there were these incredible moments. And this is the important thing that every community needs to understand, is that there are going to be tragedies. And they're at different scales. We don't all have an Edmonton in 87, but you know what? When something tragic happens, even to a single family, that's their 9/11, right? That's their 9/11. We drove into Pilger after this tornado hit, and we met this guy by the name of Gene Willers. And Gene, he's at the tail end of his career. He's an older gentleman, and Gene was the manager of the Midwest Bank in Pilger. And as the tornado started coming into town, he looked out the window of the bank, and oh my God, it's heading right for them. He's got 9 people in the bank, no storm shelter, no basement. He's got to make some decisions. And what he does is he takes all those 9 people, he puts them in the vault. The vault doesn't close or lock from the inside. Somebody's got to stay out. So he closes that vault door, and he stays out. He finds somewhere to hunker down. The bank is destroyed. He survives, they survive. But imagine, you got 15 seconds to make that decision. That's his 9/11, no matter how you slice it. So when we see these things, it looks tragic, and it is, but there's always these small little things. We see the best of a community in the face of devastation. I believe that all the best things in life involve some level of risk. So just a quick show of hands. Anybody here farm? Anybody into farming? Okay, we got a few farmers in the room. As we mentioned, right, there's some risk associated with being a farmer. And I'm not just talking about the fact that it can be a dangerous profession. I'm talking about the risk of what we're going to plant this year. The new techniques that we're going to use. The things that we hear at an event like this, putting them into practice, that's a risky proposition because it's new. Being an early adopter, new technologies, new techniques, those are risky things. But all the good stuff in life happens because of risk. If we didn't take risks, we would still be doing farming the same way we did 40 and 50 years ago, even 10 years ago. Think about how much has changed in the last 10 years that you've been in farming. All the good stuff in life involves a level of risk. As I stand before you as a tornado hunter, right, we think that I'm talking about risking my life. Nothing could be further from the truth. I got 4 kids, not interested at all in being on the cover of Reader's Digest, ever. I don't want to be that story. I'm not talking about risking my life. I'm talking about the good stuff of life. My kids playing hockey. Hockey's risky, but damn it, I love hockey, and so do my kids. Riding a motorcycle, taking your boat out on the lake, flying down south in the winter. All of these things are risky, but that's what the good stuff of life is. I had the pleasure, who's my FCC reps in the room? Is there an FCC rep in the room? FCC over here. I had the amazing pleasure a few years ago being asked to do a speaking tour for FCC across Canada, the forums. And I'm sure you guys have been to the FCC forums, and if you haven't, you should go. I had the amazing opportunity of meeting my childhood superhero. I had two of them when I was growing up, Terry Fox, Rick Hansen. And FCC gave me this amazing opportunity to meet one of my childhood superheroes. Rick and I did talks across Canada from one end of the country to the other. We flew on the airplane. We had a chance to eat meals together. I had a moment where my youngest daughter, Gabby, was sitting on Rick's lap, and he was doing wheelies through the restaurant. What a cool moment. I had a chance to become friends with my childhood superhero. And Rick said to me after a talk in Moncton, he said, there's something missing from your talk, Greg. There's something missing, and that is this idea of, you know, storm chasing and risk and all that stuff. He says, there's a difference between taking risks and being reckless. Who knows more about taking risks than Rick Hansen? Here's a guy who, at 16 years old, thrown from the bed of the pickup truck, okay, family involved in farming, thrown from the bed of a pickup truck. That was standard practice back in the day, right? Riding in the back. He was paralyzed, left on the side of the road, and he had choices to make as a 16-year-old. And today, the Rick Hansen Foundation, by far the world leader in spinal cord research, he's raised more money. He's wheeled twice around the world, 40,000 kilometers. But it's not risky. It's not reckless, I should say. It's risky. It's not reckless. It's very well planned, very well thought out, and Rick lives life for every day. Here's my particular brand of risk. And I get it, it's not for everybody. We have two types of people in this room right now. Storm's coming. Tornado warning, big black cloud coming from the Airdrie area, because that's where they always come from. We got two types of people in the room. First person here is the basement dwellers. If you are a basement dweller, hand up, please. You're hanging out in the basement, you're scared to death. And then if you didn't put your hand up, which nobody put their hand up, that means you're all closet storm chasers, right? We're sitting on the porch and we're watching that storm come in. And then we have another subset of closet storm chasers, and that's those of you who actually get in the truck and go for a drive. Who are you? Who are you? I know we got a few of you here. That's my particular brand of risk taking. I love severe weather and capturing images of storms. I've seen the biggest and the baddest tornadoes that have existed over the last 10 years. I was at El Reno for the largest tornado ever recorded on Earth, and I had my National Geographic moment with the twin EF4 tornadoes, first time that's ever been seen on Earth. This one hangs in the Fields Museum in Chicago. Tornado with a lightning strike, one of my favorites. I always try to include in my imagery our heritage, whether that be buildings, whether it be our farming background. I believe that people that are living and working on the land are the most connected people on Earth to weather. When we have discussions about climate and how it affects us, I find it offensive when we don't include our farming community, because when we think about it, we live and breathe every single day by what happens in the skies. No one is more impacted by the weather on a day-to-day basis than the people that are in this room. And so I try to include as much of that culture in those images. Greg, you mentioned it in your talk about the rural-urban mix that exists and how that's changing, and it's going to continue to change. And the more we can tell that story, and it's an amazing story, the better. We look at the values that we have in our farming communities, and those are the types of values that we want to emulate throughout our society. I love taking pictures. I love sharing the images of severe weather. And one of my favorite things to shoot is obviously lightning. And getting a chance to experience these storms all the way from Florida and Georgia and Alabama and all the way up here into the Canadian prairies is by far my greatest, I guess, joy. Here's a little bit of tornado education. So we know that on a day like today, a day like yesterday, if we put our back to the wind, so if the wind's hitting us in the back, that means we're looking at low pressure. Okay, so the wind always moves from an area of high pressure to an area of low pressure. And as we're looking at a tornado, it's important to note that a tornado is actually the center of low pressure. It's the heart of the low pressure system. And so as we're looking at it, the movies want us to believe that, oh my God, it's going to be windy and stuff's going to be blowing in our face and it's going to be like chaotic. The opposite is actually true. As I'm looking at the tornado, the wind's hitting me in the back. From this distance away, you're, you know, 80, 90 kilometers an hour. And if you see in the top left-hand corner, it might be a little bit hard to see, but there's actually a flock of birds up there on the left-hand side. And we actually watched that flock of birds get sucked into that funnel. The winds, as you get closer to the actual funnel, the pressure continues to drop, and the wind speeds continue to increase. And what that means is that everything gets pulled into that tornado. The tornado we see from the clouds down to the ground, that's the what we call the visible funnel, but the tornado exists up to 40, 50, 60,000 feet into the atmosphere. And so this idea that it rains fish or it rains frogs, that's a very real thing. As the tornado passes over a body of water, all that'll get sucked up, and then as the storm dissipates, it falls out of the clouds. You'll also notice that my safety officer, Ricky, wearing the flip-flops there in the picture, he's actually holding the door of the truck open. Without him holding the door of the truck open, the door would slam shut because the wind's hitting us from behind, being pulled in towards that funnel. You'll also notice a set of pretty impressive power poles on the right-hand side of the photo. If those power poles were on the other side of the road, we would not be in this location. We wouldn't even be on that road. Tornadoes spin counterclockwise, or what we call cyclonic. And so if those power poles come down, they're coming down into that field. Again, if they're on the other side of the road, we would not have turned onto this road. When I started storm chasing years ago, and I'm going to go back almost 10 years now, when I started storm chasing, I had one goal in mind. I wanted to stop photographing weddings, okay? I wanted to not have to ever go to another wedding again. And so the idea was to create a business where I could make a living as a storm chaser. And it was not a very crowded marketplace. There was nobody else in Canada doing that. And so I thought that there was possibly an opportunity. And for the first, I guess, 6 or so years of doing it, my goal was just to get photos, get videos, sell them to media outlets, and that's how I would make my living. And that's how it worked. And it was successful. It was good. But back in 2012, the day was June 26th. I'll never forget it. Back in 2012, the reason for storm chasing changed. And here's what happened. It was a very well forecast day. Environment Canada had given a nice lead up to this you know, what was going to be a very impressive storm day in southern Alberta and southern Saskatchewan. And we were calling for tornadoes somewhere between Moose Jaw and Swift Current. And we decided on this day to try out a new technology. We said, you know what, let's give this new technology, it was called live streaming, let's give it a go. We got enough internet feed in our truck now, let's live stream. So we mounted some cameras on the truck, and we got an internet connection, and we broadcast what we were doing to the world. Anybody on earth could tune in and watch our storm chase in southern Saskatchewan. About 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we're near Hodgeville, and big storm develops. And now we got 5,000 people watching. And as it starts to get a little bit more intense, it goes a little bit viral, and before you knew it, we had 50,000 people tuned in watching this live stream. Then about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, a funnel starts to form. And I'm like, oh my God, here it's happening on the live stream. And just as the funnel touches down, I get on the phone and I phone up Environment Canada. I phone the storm reporting line. I said, hi, this is Greg Johnson, Storm Spotter 2718. I'm on Highway 363, the worst road in Canada. And there's a large tornado on the... And I don't get the word tornado out of my mouth. And the guy on the other end of the phone at Environment Canada goes, Greg, I'm going to stop you right there. We're watching your live feed right now. We just issued the tornado warning for the city of Moose Jaw. Now, I'm going to tell you, nobody's life was saved that day. The tornado stayed out in a field. Nobody's life was in danger. But to understand that not only was Environment Canada paying attention, but 50,000 of you were paying attention to a dumb photographer with a camera talking about the weather. It showed me that not only was there a market for what we were doing, but that people care about the weather. It affects them every single day. Our weather today probably affected attendance today. Our weather last night probably affected people's ability to drive in. It affects everything that we do, and no one knows that more than farmers. This was my favorite shot of 2014. I took this at a little town in southwest Saskatchewan called Climax, Saskatchewan. This was my last shot of the night. This was my last shot of the night at Climax, Saskatchewan. Is this on? Ken, if you don't get the joke, somebody from another table will explain it a little bit later. This one I call the poopy pants photo. I call it that because after I took this shot, I invented Tornado Hunter underwear. Ken, they come in brown and yellow. Do you get the joke? Lightning strike was too close, and so I was terrified. Never seen a guy get into a truck so fast. In 2011, when I took this shot, this was my favorite shot of 2011. In 2011, we put 80,000 kilometers on our truck in 4 months, traveling. We did 19 states in 4 months, chasing storms. My favorite shot of the year was at Pence, Saskatchewan, 15 minutes from my front door. You know how much money I could have saved in 2011 on gas? The most common question I get, absolutely the most common question I get, Greg, why do you guys have to get so close? And I'm like, Mom, we've gone over this. We've talked about it. Here's the economics of storm chasing. Here's the reality that I live. So this tornado, first of all, here's the quick stats. If this was a hockey card, here are the stats of this tornado on the back of the card. It says one of the longest track tornadoes ever recorded on Earth. It was on the ground for 3 hours. Traveled 220 kilometers through central Kansas. At times, it was a mile wide with wind speeds in excess of 400 kilometers an hour. From this distance away, I'm about 15 kilometers. From this distance away, this photo made me $50. Ken, do you get it? It's not a lot of money, okay? $50, not a lot of money. About 10 minutes later, though, we're now within 500, 600 yards of the tornado. Now you can see the heavy black areas in the funnel. Those heavy black areas, that's the earth being lifted off the ground. Tornadoes don't spin around like this. Just so you know, they don't spin around like this. They corkscrew. So the vertical wind speeds, the wind going that direction, is faster in most cases than anything that's going around this way. So as we watch this tornado cross the road in front of us, those black areas are literally lifting straight off the ground. From this distance away, you can see debris in the funnel, and you can see how violent it is. From this distance away, we're talking about $4,000 to $5,000 income off of this one photo. But then about 20 seconds later, we're now 150 yards away from the tornado. You can see the asphalt being ripped off the surface of the highway. You can see individual 50-gallon drum flying around. You can see individual tree branches. You're thinking to yourself, who are the idiots in the vehicles up at the front there? Okay? From this distance away, this photo, 4 years later, I still get requests for this image. I still have media organizations contacting me because of a documentary film or something like that they would like to use this image. So when people ask me, why do you have to get so close? The answer is the economics of it. I'm just going to go back to this image real quick. This is my friend Chris. He's from Great Falls, Montana. Chris is 18 years old in this photo. This was the first opportunity that I could take him storm chasing, and his mother couldn't legally prevent me from taking him, okay? We captioned this photo, what Chris was screaming at the time of this shot, which was, "Start the truck!" 30 seconds later, he's on the floor in the back seat, and his exact words were, "My mom was right!" And he hates that I tell that story. A good kid, though. He's a chemical engineer now. I get asked all the time about our truck. And did anybody see it as you drove in this morning? I have it parked outside here. I get asked about our truck all the time. People say, "Greg, you drive a Ford F-150. You must be able to go really fast in that Ford F-150 with the EcoBoost." And I'm like, yeah, we sure can go fast in that Ford F-150 with the aluminum body panels. I'm contractually obligated to say Ford F-150 four times in every presentation. Truth of the matter is that we don't have to go all that fast. We don't. I mean, tornadoes, ground speed, the Moose Jaw tornado was going 0 kilometers an hour, stayed in the same field for 25 minutes, didn't go anywhere. The Edmonton tornado was moving roughly 40 to 45 kilometers an hour, and the fastest one I ever saw was at Joplin, Missouri, was moving about 80 kilometers an hour. So they don't have to move all that fast. I mean, 80 kilometers an hour, even if you're driving a Sierra, you can go 80 kilometers an hour, right? Right? I mean, for those of you with a Dodge Ram, maybe not, but it's close. It's close. But we don't have to drive all that fast, okay? We don't have to drive all that fast. But we do get stopped by law enforcement all the time. Very rare, regular thing for us to get stopped by law enforcement, but here's the reason why. The dude who's sitting in that that police vehicle, his job is to manage public safety. There's a tornado warning, there's a big dark cloud. He's looking at that scene exactly as you or I would. He's looking at his phone app for the weather the way you or I would, and he doesn't particularly have any great information. They stop us because they go, maybe these guys have something that can help us out. When we act as a first responder, we're always on scene with that first state trooper that shows up at that rollover or shows up at that town that got hit. And so we get stopped a lot, and we get to share that experience with those law enforcement professionals. This particular photo was at a place called Buffalo, Oklahoma. We were just a little bit west of town, and storm chasing is actually the wrong terminology for what we do. We don't actually very often chase after a tornado. What happens is, tornado touches down, we actually want to position in front of it. And then as it gets uncomfortably close to us, we hop in the truck and we reposition to that new spot. We kind of leapfrog out in front, and we keep doing this until the storm dissipates. We were in Oklahoma, and this is what happened. The tornado touched down right above the road, perfect scenario for us, and we were repositioning out in front of it. And on one of our repositioning moves, I look over at Ricky, who's like white-knuckling it on the steering wheel. His face is just like straight, and I'm like, "Ricky, what's wrong?" "We're out of gas." "Like, how out of gas?" "Like, we shouldn't be moving right now." And so I said, "Guys, okay, we got to leave the tornado. We got to leave the tornado. We got to get." And I checked the GPS. There's a small town, Buffalo, Oklahoma, just up the road. So we take off. We leave the storm. We get to Buffalo on fumes. We pull in, and we do our NASCAR pit stop. Okay? So one guy jumps out, starts pumping gas. One guy runs in for chips and pop and beef jerky. And one guy gets to use the bathroom, and one guy pays for the gas, and we do that as fast as we can. We're wrapping up our pit stop, and the tornado sirens in town start going off. Everybody scatters for the storm shelters. We get in the truck, and we bolt out of town. We get about 4 miles out of town, and Oklahoma State Trooper with the cherries on is flying up behind us. This portly kind of state trooper walls up to the next of the truck. And I said, "Officer, you can't be pulling us over for speeding. There's a tornado on the ground." He says, "I'm not pulling you over for speeding. You stole gas in Buffalo." See, it was my job to pay for the gas. But as the storm sirens are going off, I forgot. But here's the deal. This trooper was the first on scene. A few years prior, small town of Greensburg, Kansas was hit with a tornado. Destroyed every building in town, several fatalities, and this trooper was one of the first responders on the scene. The other people that were there with him were storm chasers, people that were actually following along, documenting the storm, and broadcasting what was happening. They were the people that were shoulder to shoulder with him as he entered this community. So he had a bit of a connection to us in a way. And so I gave him $75, and he claims that at the end of his shift, he was going to go pay for the gas, but there may be a warrant for my arrest somewhere in Oklahoma. In 2015, the largest tornado in North America for the year, the largest tornado of the year, actually occurred on Canadian soil, and it happened in Manitoba, and a couple days prior to that, we were down in Arizona, right at Tucson, right at the Mexican border, and we looked at the forecast, and we went, man, southwest Manitoba, that's where we need to be on Monday. So we drove two straight days, we crossed the border into Manitoba at about 6 o'clock in the evening. At about 6:30, we got out of the truck, we looked above us, I took this photo straight above my head, and I said to the guys, "We're in the right spot." And within just a couple of minutes, we had the first of three tornadoes on the day that touched down. I'm going to show you a short video of that event. What you're going to see here is 20 minutes of tornado condensed into 1 minute. The guys in the orange jackets are the film crew. The one sound guy running towards the tornado, that's our 65-year-old sound man, and I think you will enjoy this. Shameless plug for the TV show as well. So what you saw there was 20 minutes condensed into 1 minute as we were driving towards this tornado. Very well-behaved tornado, stayed right over top of the road for its entire two-hour life cycle, ended up near Verdon, Manitoba at the end of 2 hours in the middle of the dark, which was terrifying, but it didn't affect that community. As you can see here, our truck, we talked about being reckless versus taking risks. Our truck is bulletproof. It was actually sprayed right here in Medicine Hat at the Linex dealer. The roll cage built in Red Deer, Alberta, at a place called Light Industries. and it's built to withstand a mine collapse. It was built for the potash industry, and we repurposed it for storm chasing. We have live Doppler radar in the truck, which allows us to slice the storm open and understand exactly where it's going, what the threat is, and where it's moving to. So with all of those tools at our disposal, it takes the recklessness out of what we're doing. The storm, that tornado did actually hit a few farmyards. This one you can see just passed by this one farmyard. Environment Canada issued a 25-minute, ahead of time, a 25-minute advanced warning of an impending tornado. Huge victory for Environment Canada, huge victory for the meteorology community. And although there were six farms that were destroyed in a very low population area, there were no fatalities and no injuries. So that was a huge day. The tornado was so strong, in fact, at times that it lifted the asphalt right off the highway surface. Now, I know what you're thinking because you've driven in Saskatchewan. That's just any road in Saskatchewan. But believe me, in Manitoba, this was a big deal. As I mentioned, 2014, got to experience my National Geographic moment, right? Anybody who's ever picked up a camera has the same goal in mind, right? Get your picture on the cover of the Sports Illustrated Swimsuit Edition. But I have never got that, but National Geographic is a close second. So here's what happened that day. We had, again, a very well-forecast day. We drove from Regina, Saskatchewan, down to Nebraska in time to catch twin EF4 tornadoes, two tornadoes, both with wind speeds in excess of 400 kilometers an hour, about a mile wide and a mile apart on the ground at the same time. It's never been seen before on Earth. And we had a front row seat. At times, we had one on one side of the road and one on the other side of the road. And again, a very, very surreal experience. This past year, in 2016, we had probably the tornado event of a lifetime, which was at Dodge City, Kansas. And we witnessed a long-lived supercell, long-lived tornado experience that lasted about an hour and 20 minutes. And was completely photogenic. And the big deal here was that even though this massive tornado came very close to several communities, it didn't damage anything. It missed towns, it missed farms, it missed communities, it missed anything that could be considered catastrophic. And that's very, very unusual. I'm going to show you a quick video that shows a number of these tornadoes. It doesn't take very long here, but I think you will enjoy it.
Whoa, was that intense? Look at that. Oh, come on, let's cross the road, bring it through us.
East, you can do it now.
Oh no! Oh my! Oh! Oh
gotta be in the basement. Oh, this is terrible.
Oh, look at that. Whoa.
Yeah. Look at that, on the right. Oh my God. Whoa. Oh. Stop the wipers, I think we're good.
Get ahead of us.
Yep.
To go storm chasing. Same dude, right over there. Excellent. That last scene, scariest moment of my life, that was the El Reno tornado, 2013, Oklahoma. this was the largest tornado ever recorded on Earth. It grew to be from 200 yards wide, it grew to be 2.6 miles, just over 4 kilometers wide, in just over a minute. Our experience was like that baseball joke. Do you know the baseball joke? The one that goes, I couldn't understand why the baseball was getting bigger, and then it hit me. Well, it was kind of like that. Like, in our world, if the tornado's getting bigger, that means it's moving towards you. this thing wasn't moving towards us. What happened was it grew. And unfortunately, as far as, you know, quickly as we tried to get south and get away from it, we were on a little farm road, wasn't very wide, and the vehicle in front of us actually stopped. And the reason he stopped was, it turns out it was a good friend of mine, Brandon Sullivan, and I was kind of like swearing a little bit. I was like, why is this guy stopping? Well, it turns out a round bale had actually landed on the front end of his Jeep, and they were disabled. They couldn't go anywhere. So we took our truck into the ditch. The tornado, as you saw, the barn next to us basically exploded into a million pieces, and it was scary. It was really scary. When we were live streaming when that happened, we had 20,000 people tuned in, and when our truck landed, we were in the air about 4 or 5 feet, about 3 or 4 times, and as it landed and bounced, the laptop running the cameras slammed shut. And so anybody who was watching our live stream saw, oh, look, a tornado, this is great. Oh, man, this is great. Why is it, it seems like it's moving towards us. We should get going. And, F-bomb, and then lost signal. My mom was watching. Now, to say it was the scariest day of my life, there was the phone call later to my mom. That was the scariest, but it was not a day that we were happy about. But there were some amazing things that happened that day, and that is that the tornado happened within 20 miles of the National Weather Service in Oklahoma. There were 18 Doppler on wheels trucks studying that storm, and here's how good the forecasting is: we woke up in a hotel room. The morning of the El Reno tornado, we woke up in a hotel room in El Reno, Oklahoma. 24 hours beforehand, we put a pin in a map and said, that's where we need to go. And we weren't alone. A lot of people put that same pin in the map. And so that just speaks to how good the technology's come and how well the forecasting behaves now. This year's Dodge City, Kansas tornado produced some of the most incredible tornado images that we've seen in a generation. It almost looks like a computer-generated graphic. It's that perfect. Again, what was so special about Dodge City was that it didn't hit anything. There was very, very little human impact. You see, it turns out that all these weather events, hurricanes, tornadoes, blizzards, the list goes on, they're just weather events. They don't become disasters until they actually affect our communities. This one was an incredible weather event, but it's not always that way. As you can appreciate, we watch the news, we know that a lot of times really bad stuff happens. On this particular day, this was in Arkansas. This is the Arkansas River floodplain just west of Little Rock, Arkansas. It was just before dark, just in the 20, 30 minutes just before darkness set in. And the National Weather Service in Arkansas issued what we call a PDS tornado warning, a particularly dangerous situation. What's amazing about the forecasting down in the States is that they use what we call plain language to describe their tornado warnings. On this particular day, they said, a large, devastating tornado has developed west of Little Rock. It's moving northeast at about 40 miles an hour. This is a tornado capable of destroying entire neighborhoods. If you're not underground, you die. Now, if you hear that tornado warning, I think you're going to find shelter somewhere. So we were following this storm, darkness fell, and all of a sudden, we're chasing a monster mile-wide tornado in the dark. You can't see it. You can only view it on radar, and you have your GPS position, and that's great. But on the horizon, you can see, from time to time, you can see a big white-green power flash, an arc of light as a power transformer explodes, and we know that the tornado's over there. And the floodplain turns into the jungle, and we were in trees and hills, and as I look at the radar, I realize that there's three small towns in the path of this tornado, and it's after dark. Worst case scenario. We arrived into Valonia, Arkansas, and I know this is a very, very difficult photo to see, but what you're looking at is the neighborhood that we drove into 4 minutes after a devastating tornado had hit. Is it still up there? I can't even see myself up there. When we arrived in town, the only lights that anybody could see in this community were the lights from our truck. The power's out. All the homes are destroyed. These are brick homes that are in this photo. And they've been completely demolished. And not to make light of it at all, but it was kind of like a zombie apocalypse. If you can imagine that the only lights you can see are the lights from our truck, people started coming out of the darkness in this neighborhood, and they started coming towards the only lights they could see. They're covered in mud. Their clothes have been torn or ripped off. There's injuries, lots of injuries. And we're very fortunate. We travel. We have two trucks. We have an EMT that drives our production truck, and we had two trauma kits, two trauma bags. We set up a little triage station, a little first aid station, and we went to work doing first aid. As people arrived that weren't injured, they contributed to the first aid, and we had a lot of people helping out. And we did that for about an hour and a half. And during that time, during the 9/11 type situation for this community, it's been completely devastated. Although there is a lot of like poignant, sad moments, there was these incredible moments where you see families come together. I haven't seen you in an hour and a half. You know, things have been destroyed, and you see people come together. Amazing moments. You see people, like, politics doesn't matter. Race doesn't matter. Friendships don't matter. Everyone's just helping everybody out. And there was also funny moments, believe it or not. There was moments that made you laugh. Like, there was this one gentleman comes up, and he's got a cut on his arm. And he's a pretty bad cut, but as I'm talking to him, he's giving me the 1,000-yard stare, right? Like, there's nothing between the eyes right now. He's just, like, he's off. He's in a different place. And he's shivering, even though it's, like, great, crazy warm out. He's shivering. He's going into shock. So we got him a jacket. We put it around him and sat him down. And the whole time we're dressing his wounds, the whole time I'm trying to talk to him, one of his three little girls, he came with his three little girls, and one of his three little girls is saying, I got puke in my hair. I got puke in my hair back here. It's mostly on this side over here. And then she starts going into like the texture of it and describing the texture of the puke in her hair. And she starts going into like what they had for supper and which of her sisters puked on her and everything. And we all had a little bit of a nervous chuckle about this until we heard the story. So Dad and the girls are in the living room watching television. Tornado sirens are going off. But tornado sirens go off all the time down there, right? No big deal. He gets a text from a friend, one line. It says, it's headed your way. He's got 15 seconds. He takes his three girls and does exactly what they've always been trained and told to do. Just like a fire drill in our schools, they do a tornado drill. He doesn't have a basement. He doesn't have a storm shelter. He's got 15 seconds. He takes the three girls, puts them in the bathtub, climbs in the bathtub on top of them. The tornado passes over top. Nothing left of the house except for a little bit of the interior structure, which included the bathroom, and the four of them survived. And man, I heard that, and I was like, that's a moment. Like, that's a thing. That's a story. And there were lots of those that night. After about 2 hours, and it's really too bad you can't see this photo. After about 2 hours of doing first aid, an hour and a half of doing first aid, we decided we were going to go out and look around this community. This was the third of three small towns that had been hit. We still have no emergency personnel on site. So a bunch of us put on headlamps, and we started walking around this community. And we would come up to a pile of rubble, and we would say, can anybody hear me? If you can hear me, give us some kind of sign. Give us some kind of response. And if there was no response, we would maybe call out one more time, and then we would move on. At about 3 o'clock in the morning, I was actually on the other side of the road. Ricky was on this side, and he calls out, "Can anybody hear me? If you can hear us, give us some kind of response." And then from underneath this pile of rubble, which used to be a home, he can hear people screaming. And we spent the next hour and a half or so by hand pulling this pile of rubble off until we got down to the door in the floor. Now, for those of you with a confined spaces fear, let me paint this picture. You open up that little door. There's a little cement staircase that goes down, about 4 feet wide, about 10 feet long, and there were three families in there, including a little infant, and they'd been trapped in there for about 4.5 hours. Now, to say that it was a life moment to see the look on their face as they walked out of that hole, and I'm sure they're telling the same story going, if you would have seen the look on their faces. But it's true, it was one of those moments that, like, within a few seconds, we were all in tears, we were all holding on to each other, strangers, all holding on to each other. It was their 9/11 moment. And to be part of that, as much as we never want to be in those scenes, you never want to be a first responder, hope I never see that stuff ever again. But to be there at that time was life-changing. Sadly, we've been to a lot of these. This was at Joplin, Missouri. I'm taking pictures here of the air ambulance that was ripped off the top of the hospital and thrown. Joplin, Missouri sustained a direct hit. 10,000 buildings destroyed, 20,000 vehicles, and it was a moment that for that community was their 9/11. We were there at Ground Zero. We were at the epicenter of this event. And again, even in these types of events, we have these amazing moments that exist. The best of a community happens in the face of tragedy. I can tell you that as many as of these that I've been to, it's always amazing to me that people come together in the face of tragedy. Within hours, from hundreds of miles around, volunteers, firefighters, police, and just regular Joes showing up to do what they can. And funny moments. Oh my gosh. We pull into this spot, just actually to the left of this picture. We pulled into a parking lot where we were going to park our truck so we could go out and do our filming. And as we pulled into this parking lot, oh my gosh, my heart sank. I looked over. I said, "Guys, there's a leg over there. Oh my gosh, there's an arm over there. There's a foot over here." Turns out we were in the parking lot of a prosthetics clinic across from the hospital. And I'm not going to say it wasn't nervous laughter. It was nervous laughter. But it was a moment that we needed because it broke that tension. As we walked around this community, we saw one gentleman who was just wandering around by himself, looked in a daze, and I said, "Sir, do you need any help?" He said, "I'm just trying to find my street." Turns out there's no landmarks left. There's nothing to point them in the right direction. But we do. We see these pretty much everywhere we go. This is Moore, Oklahoma. There's a guy up here in the top right-hand corner. He's actually standing. If you can see that, he's standing on his dad's truck. An hour before we arrived, they pulled his dad alive out of this pile of rubble. No storm shelter, no basement, but as the tornado hit, Dad crawled up under. There's this big, heavy wooden captain's chair that he crawled under, and that saved his life. A few cuts and bruises, but he saved his life. So I said to the gentleman, I said, "Do you mind if I interview you? This is a great story." So he said, "Sure, no problem." I had him sitting here, I'm sitting here, my cameraman over my shoulder, and I'm asking him questions, and I'm writing notes. And out of the corner of my eye, there's a lady just off to the side who showed up, and she's anxious to talk to him. So I stop the interview, and she walks over to him, and in her hand, she has a mittful of photographs. Some of them are torn, some of them are wet, they're not in great shape, but she hands them to him and says, "I believe these are your dad's." Now, I was fine. My cameraman was in tears, but I was fine. But it was a moment that made me realize that, like, I'm not just a dumb photographer, right? It's not about being just a farmer. It's not about being just a photographer. That was a real moment. And people care about things like the weather, and it turns out we care about things like photographs. We've all played the little game in our head. Your house is burning down. You got time to go in and get, like, one thing. What are you getting? No one ever answers the new microwave. Not ever. The big screen TV, the new bed, none of that stuff. We care about those things we call the scrapbook of our lives, so those moments, that one picture we have on the wall of Granddad from the war. It's the only picture we have left of him. That's the thing we grab. I don't have a death wish. I have a life wish. Like I said, I don't want to be on the cover of Reader's Digest. I don't want to be that guy. I'm not going to take unnecessary risks to do what I do. I have a life wish. I got four kids that I have to take care of. I got to teach my son how to fish. If he doesn't know how to fish, by the time I'm off this planet, there's a problem, right? And when he gets older, I want to teach him how to catch bigger fish, right? I want to take my kids and teach them how to ride their bikes. This is the legacy that I have to pass on. And we all have that. That's why we need to stay safe, whether we're whether we're working as a storm chaser or working as a statistically more dangerous job as being a farmer. I want to be able to take my kid to the beach and have her get mad at me when we have to leave. She's the same one that was giving me the finger earlier, by the way. But she's an angel, and they're great kids, and that's why we do all the things that we do, whether it's making our community better, making our families better, making our businesses better. An organization like this and all the stuff that you see throughout the trade show portion, all the speakers you're going to hear are way more important than what I have to say, but they're all designed to do the same thing. Make your operation better this year than it was last year. Make your ability to mitigate risk better this year than it was last year. And that's really why we're all here. So I'm going to leave you with this last photo. This is one that I shot in Montana a couple years ago, just south of here. And one of my favorite, this is down near Great Falls. Just leave you with this one and just say, you know, again, thank you, Ken, and your team for having me out. Ton of fun. I'm going to be here for a little bit in the lobby. I've got some books if anybody's interested. I don't know how we're doing on time, but if we have a few minutes, I'm open to any questions. But again, thank you so much for having me out.
I think we've definitely got 5 minutes for questions. People have some questions, so great opportunity. I have one question just to start off.
So yep.
I'm curious what relationship you have with other storm chasers. Do you network? Do you work together? Do you help each other chase down storms? Or is it sometimes it's sort of competitive as well with other storm chasers?
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly a competition, but in the same way that there's a competition amongst farmers, you know, you go to the farm tech or you go to Agribition or something and they have a grain competition and you want to win it, but you don't begrudge the guy who does. So yeah, there's a friendly competition, sometimes that manifests itself as like one time we were the Weather Network sends down a storm chase team every year, and we're really good friends with the Weather Network guys. And after the Dodge City tornado, we ended up in the same hotel. Okay, so we had a few drinks and whatnot, and in the morning. We go out to our truck and we load everything up and we get on the road and I hear this coming from the back end of my truck. I hear tick, 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 and it's just getting worse as we're driving along. And I'm like, oh, I go, guys, today's a big storm day. We can't have car trouble. We better stop at the Ford dealer and see what's wrong. So we pull into the Ford dealer, we wait and they check it out. And he comes out and he goes, there doesn't seem to be anything wrong, but it's weird. There was a cable tied around your drive shaft. And every time it went around, it would hit the bottom of the truck. So we're like, well, that's weird, right? So we're driving down the road, and this is in Kansas. We're driving down the road, and oh, there's the Weather Network guys. So so we pass by them, and we toot, and we wave, hey, how are you doing? And then about 30 seconds later, my phone rings, and I answer, and it's George Coronis. And he says, do you guys have any car trouble this morning? I went, you jerk. So yeah, it's friendly rivalry. Yes?
So I heard you speak 2 years ago.
Yep.
And you were saying.
Same jokes? Is that what you're going to. Okay. Whew! These ones were better?
Yeah, I'm doing.
Oh, excellent. Good.
You're improving.
Thanks, man. Thanks.
You were commenting how Canada needs to come up to speed more so with our warnings and stuff, and how the United States, when you gave that description, look, the storm's coming your way. If you're not out of it, you're dead. Don't be dumbass.
Yep.
And so are we getting better in Canada?
Yeah, you bet. You know, Alberta's actually been the leader. So the rest of the country, in case you don't know, here in Alberta, the provincial warning system that you had became a model for the feds. And so now they've rolled that out across Canada for breaking into programming on television and radio and the alert system via smartphone and all those kind of things. So that actually has now been rolled out. Environment Canada is actually now even monitoring Twitter. And a couple years ago when we had talked, you know what, none of those things were happening. Environment Canada doesn't have a technology or a human resource problem. Great people, best meteorologists in the world. They have a communication problem. And, you know, the wheels of the federal government turn slowly. And Environment Canada being an extension of that. So are they getting there? You bet. But it does take time. We're not to that same point that they are in the U.S., But from a policy standpoint, maybe it should be more important, but yeah. But we're getting better. Yes, sir.
So you have any problems getting across the border and stuff?
No, in fact, we've crossed the border many times without passports. We've been expecting to chase on the Canadian side of the border. Something pops up down at Havre, Montana. We'll hit the border crossing and explain what we're doing. And at most of the regular border crossings, it's like they recognize us, where are you going today, and all that kind of stuff. So no, they don't ever really cause us any issue. So how much is my life insurance premium? Well, sir, it's funny you should ask that. You know what, we have several insurance organizations, which are, I'm going to call, partners with what we do. So partners or sponsors. Weather is so important to the insurance community that as opposed to seeing us as a liability, I think we're seen as a positive part of the insurance piece. And so I've done a lot of work for insurance organizations over the last 5 or 6 years. When it comes to my vehicle, Saskatchewan Government Insurance, everyone's covered the same. Isn't it weird, too? Aren't we in an alternate universe right now? Like, in Saskatchewan, we have a conservative government. And here in Alberta, you don't. And I think back to a few years ago when the Alberta, you know, there's a little bit of fun being made in Saskatchewan, and That's kind of flipped, which is kind of fun right now. So. I don't get road hazard glass, though. Yes?
Do you find that the severe weather events are increasing over the years or staying the same?
So this is the climate question, right? Is it getting worse, right? Greg, is it going to hell in a handcart? The truth of the matter is, and I think the scientists have done a really good job of not trying to connect the dots between a daily weather event and climate change. The media, different story, right? Like, anytime a small town in Nebraska gets hit, it's a sign of climate change. The truth of the matter is the last 5 years have been the tornado recession. So sincerely, if you're a storm chaser, these have been the five slowest years since they've been keeping records in the 1950s. Hurricanes, every decade since the 1850s, North America has seen between 18 to 20 landfalls of hurricanes. In the last 11 years, Matthew, which just grazed the Florida coast this fall, Matthew was the first major hurricane to make landfall in the United States in 11 years. So is it getting worse? Well, weather doesn't say anything, but I'm not a climate scientist, so I can't comment on the climate thing, but I can tell you that our experience with severe weather is, you know, I don't know, have we had a fall like this before on the prairies? Probably. I'm not seeing sort of like from a tornado standpoint, hurricane standpoint, not seeing those effects. But like I said, I think the scientists do a good job of not trying to connect those two dots.
I think we'll shut it down here. So
awesome. We got one more. He was doing the ooh.
Sam was up
before.
Question for you.
Yes.
I really enjoy your photography. Where can I find it?
TornadoHunter.com. And that wasn't a plant. Honest to God, that wasn't. You can
ask him about his books.
You can also get them in my book that's for sale in the lobby right now. So, thank you guys very much.